We appreciate you taking your time to attend this training today. Today's training will be in panel discussion and will be around 1 hour. So we are very honored to have the facilitator, Mr. Mike Williams, senior partner of Gaining Edge from Australia, and the three speakers. And they are Mr. Brad Crandall, senior vice president strategy of Global Activation Team of PICO Global from Hong Kong, Mr. Olindo Oliveira, director of live communications of MCI Group from Macau, and Mr. Thomas Gray, business development manager of Events Air from Australia. So now, may I invite Mr. Benson now, the president of Macau Trade and Investment Promotion Institute, to deliver a speech for us.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Thank you so much for starting a brand new day with us on Zoom and showing us your support towards our newly launched Meet at Macau EPIM online seminars. I hope our training sessions can fill you with new thoughts and ideas on how to energize your business event in the post-COVID era. First of all, I would like to express my gratitude to Mr. Mike Williams of Gaining Edge, who will be our facilitators for today, and our two upcoming training seminars. With his vast knowledge and experience, Mike will be linking the insight of all the speakers with his expertise and give us our parameters on the future business events. Furthermore, I have to extend my appreciation to all the speakers for sharing with us their professional knowledge and giving our industrial inspirations to sustain and strive in uncertain times. As we all know, digitalization is one of the most influential global megatrends lately, thus making the role of hybrid events more important than ever before in the world of business events. Hybrid event attracts both in-person and virtual attendees, connecting groups of participation across different cities, countries, or continents to share a live and collective experience. They are not just a new trend, but also a key element of sustainable business strategy, especially in the post-COVID world. Live events can never be replaced, but hybrid elements can give us an important competitive edge. I believe our three distinguished speakers, Mr. Oliveira, Mr. Gray, and Mr. Gondo, will give us their professional insights on the new trends today. Last but not least, thank you again for participating in this seminars, which you all present day. Thank you.
Thank you, Benson Lau, the new president of IPM, for that opening message. Joe-san, and good morning, and welcome to IPM Macau's first online training seminar. It's good to all to meet you all. I'm sorry I'm not there in person to see you all, but we've got a great attendance this morning of over 120 people, which is, I think, a record for an IPM session, so thank you for participating. Just a couple of quick notes before we kick off the session. One is that if you've got any questions, please type them up on the chat box, and Nigel, my colleague from Gaining Edge, will be sort of putting those questions up later on during the session. And just to kick off, I just want to give you an introduction to what this is all about today. One of the consequences, as Benson has mentioned, of COVID-19 is the fast tracking of digital technologies for the business events industry. And for more than a decade, our industry's been looking at ways to adapt and monetize these technologies. But now the industry has little choice but to upskill and embrace the new virtual experience economy. This session is going to provide you with great insights into how some of the industry innovative leaders like Events Air, PICO, and MCI Group are moving forward to create virtual and hybrid events that best complement and replicate the benefits of live events. Our message today is hybrid is here to stay as part of the post-COVID era. It's not here to replace live events, but to open up new possibilities and business opportunities for the business events industry and attendees at conferences and exhibitions. I'd like to welcome our panelists today. One local, Alinto Olivia, who kind of splits between Macau and Hong Kong. He's an award-winning event producer, and he and his team consult on design and delivery on a variety of digital, hybrid and live experiences and activations across the APAC region for some of the global's biggest brands. We also have the man from Silicon Valley, Greg Grandel, who's Senior Vice President of Global Action Team from PICO. He started off his career, I understand, in Silicon Valley and relocated to Asia about 20 years ago. Greg joined PICO in 2017 and based in Hong Kong, focusing on building the bridge between content, data technology, and live experiences to help brands make deeper connections and a growing connection with a growing generation of digital customers. And finally, based out down in Brisbane, Australia, Thomas Gray, APAC Business Development Manager, Events Air Australia. Thomas is a passionate and a confident and motivated business development manager with almost a decade of experience in the technology space and events industry, working with Centium Software Events Air for over 8 years, winning business and building relationships to help us grow from a lean startup to the leader in our space. So welcome the panelists. We've got some of the industry's best on call to answer your questions today. So welcome and look forward to having discussions with you now. Let's kick off. I'm going to start with you, Greg. We need to perhaps give a short introduction of what is actually a hybrid event and how does it differ from virtual and other forms of meetings. So, Greg, can you give us a bit of an insight there? Thanks, Mike.
Thanks, Mike, and thanks, everybody, for having me. So I think the best way to answer that question is to go back to the beginning a little bit about what happened. I think once this COVID hit, I think we were all in quite a bit of shock and ourselves as well. MICE is a really important business for us, trade shows, conferences, events, all the same type of business. I think we were thrown into the same shock as you were. And I think we were thrown into the same shock as a lot of the brands and the companies and the organizers that used to do these events. I think the first phase, people either, you know, events were canceled or postponed. I think some brands went under the bunker. And then some brands went immediately onto a virtual world. So they started doing their events. So I think we had, right at that time in March, we had Huawei have in 10 days stop their physical event and then go online. Not everybody could do that. So people sort of fell in those two directions. Either I'm going to postpone and delay and hold on, or I'm going to spin to virtual. And it was easier for companies and easier for not. So what's happened over the course of the last 4 or 5 months, you can hear there's just so much work going on to virtual. Some folks have said, okay, now let's build our audiences up. So they've been doing visual spaces. They've been doing their trade events in there. They've been doing their product launches in there. And this business is new. Even for ourselves, it was very difficult to turn around and get everybody to sort of reprogram from the traditional head of doing physical events to going into virtual events. And I think what's happening now is in places and spaces where we can start doing live events, especially in China, we can start to marry the two. It's not a matter of switching now between going to a physical event and saying, okay, well, I give up on the digital side. It's about how can I marry what's going on in digitally and add what's going on with the virtual audience with the live audience. So we're pairing up the two. So what's happening now is I'm seeing in China, we've got live events going on now, audiences of 600 to 1,000 people, but then the broadcast audiences of the audiences that want to participate in that event are becoming active and engaged in that physical event. So I think the hybrid answer is our launch pad to get our live events back, but they will always now have a relationship with the virtual audience.
Thanks, Greg. So, Tom, how do you see the future of virtual, hybrid, and live events? Can they live together, and which of these platforms is going to dominate?
Thank you, and thanks, everyone, for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. So I think we're still in the infancy of hybrid. Virtual has really been what we've all been getting our hands stuck into in the last couple of months. It was a really quick pivot, as Greg mentioned there, from live events to virtual, and some really quite agile movers and shakers at the start really did that quite quickly. And I think a lot of the key players in the industry have also started moving in that direction. I think a lot of people initially thought, hey, let's just hold out and hopefully this will all blow over. But I think most of us now realize that that's not the case. We really need to embrace this new change. So what we've seen amongst our customers in our industry, particularly here in Australia, was a very quick pivot to virtual events, completely online, whether that's a Zoom or all the way through to a fully interactive virtual conference. And what we're starting to see now is a pivot to hybrid. And hybrid comes with its own set of challenges, but you know what it means from an opportunities perspective is that you've got a much broader reach of audience. And I think all of the lessons that we've learned in the period of going virtual can be really well applied to hybrid. And I think another thing that's really working in hybrid events' favor is the mindset shift that individuals and industries and corporations have gone through in the last couple of months, that it's okay to interact online. In fact, it can be, while not as great as a live event, it can have its own benefits and it can be a really good experience as long as the content's right and the delivery's gotten right. So, you know, that combined with all the learnings of the technology that we're getting right in this period mean that hybrid events are just going to get more and more engaging moving forward. And what that means is there's a much broader audience available to you to engage with via a hybrid event, where typically you might only be able to have a small subset of people come to the actual event due to restrictions on the actual venue size or travel restrictions. Now by broadcasting that out to a broader audience, you're really, the sky's the limit of who you can engage with.
Right, thanks a lot, Tom. And Alinto, how's MCI seeing the trend at the moment? Is the future virtual, hybrid, live combination? Who's gonna dominate? Do you have a sense of a time frame for this as well?
Oh yeah, sure. So, first off, thanks so much. It's a pleasure to be here and be able to share a bit and talk about the future of the industry. I think, both Greg and Tom really already said a lot of what's happening, and I think they were really good answers. To kind of piggyback on that a little bit, I think, you know, to Greg's point, one of the things that we noticed very early on with our clients, and it's interesting to see the mentality. It was very clear there were two kind of mentalities there with the brands and the clients that we were working with. And now it's very clear to see which ones are doing better than others. There were brands that looked at it and either hunkered down, like Rick said, and started asking questions like, oh, what's our digital event strategy? And then there was another set of brands that we looked at and were saying, hey, what's our strategy and how do we implement digital into it? And it's a very different shift, right? You're not looking at it as something that's completely different. You're looking at it as how do we integrate this into how we do business? And those companies today we see are doing much better already. They've been able to continue to engage with their audiences. They've been able to grow their audiences even because they didn't think about like, oh, let's try and reinvent the wheel. They just looked at it and said, okay, how do we shift what we're already doing to take advantage of what is now a new normal? Or at least in the beginning, what we were thinking was just going to be something short term, which now we understand is going to be around for much, much longer than that. I think the second thing is, we were all in shock, like Greg said, and you know, in the beginning we were all trying to figure this out. But the truth is, and we actually spoke about this last week when we caught up, you know, hybrid events is nothing new. It's just new to the business events side of things. And when you look at sporting events in particular, they've been hybrid for a very long time. They're highly profitable, they're highly engaging. And, it's just about us now looking around and understanding what's worked in other verticals and being able to adapt that to the business side or the business events side of things. So, I think that it's here to stay. I think that it's not necessarily that one format or one platform will dominate the others. I think it's just about looking at what's going to work best for the outcomes that you want for a specific event. It's not that, oh, we should make everything hybrid, or it's not that, oh, we should just make everything digital. I think that hybrid has obvious pros and obvious benefits when you're looking at in terms of reach, in terms of shareability, tracking of how audiences engage with your brands. But it's not so much about like, oh, this is going to be the best solution. I think it really just comes down to what's the outcome that you're looking at when you're putting together an experience. And so based on that outcome, what's the best medium to get there and to reach those desired goals?
So I guess the message is it's not going away. There's a place for everything. And it's a question of just looking at what's best for the client. But You know, do you all think that hybrid and live and virtual are a good marriage to benefit the industry overall? Great.
Yeah, I mean, I think Alita said it actually the best. Our business, whether we're suppliers or whether we're venues, is experience design, right? And so the only thing that's happened is that the tools have changed. So we've got an added tool for it. And I think one of the things you were asking is to say, we did an event in Shanghai last month in July. It was 650 people. It was Yonex. It was their big developers conference, putting all their equipment in there and all their new latest displays in the show floor. And they were doing breakout sessions and classes and things. So the audience live that they could get away with about 650 people, but they had 1 million people online.
Wow. Good.
So you've got 1,650,000 at my experience instead of 650. And so I think for that, and they had some of the stars couldn't be there, but some of the stars were doing breakout sessions in the rooms. I mean, this is the part where there's a symbiotic relationship between the two. And we really must understand how this experience is going to marry the two of them. And again, we were talking last week and I was saying, you know, how can the Italian, you know, guy who wants to go for the exhibit, put an exhibit into Macau? Right, and he can't get on the plane or restrictions are there. At least now we could build them a booth there in Macau and put local talent to be able to represent that company's brands there in Macau and do it in a live situation, whether it's telepresence or things like that. I think we can bring people into those exhibits that wouldn't normally be able to make it there because we're a lot more digital savvy, a lot more accelerated into digital power. I mean, there's hiccups along the way. I mean, none of this is set in stone. We're bolting stuff as fast as we can. So,
yeah. Thanks, Greg. I mean, just looking at our audience attendance today, we've got 120 people. I see a lot of hotels, venues, suppliers to the industry there, and obviously IPM represents the destination. What are the implications to the destinations and venues and hotels and suppliers that are relying on physical attendance and presence of their things? Is it a major threat to them, or is it something they can find a way through to find a solution to still attract on-site delegates as well as marrying with the hybrid concept? Maybe Tom, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, sure. Thanks. I think there's been a lot of concern out there initially about potentially, you know, cannibalizing an audience that might potentially come in person to an event. And, you know, giving too compelling an online offering might then mean we don't get anyone showing up to the event. I really don't think that's really truly a threat. You know, all of you in the room, you're in from quite a dynamic, vibrant part of the world. I think people will always still want to travel to these kind of events and get that live in-person interaction where they possibly can. I think the big takeout with it is, though, hybrid's really the only way you can get those people from overseas at the moment while we can't travel. So it's one of those things that, you know, I really don't think the threat's there. You know, if you look at the key surveys as to why people go to business events, unfortunately for all the speakers, it's not the content. It's usually the food, the location, the gala dinner that they put on forever and afterwards. It's those kind of experiences. It's also the connections they get to meet. You know, you hear a lot of sponsors, you know, talking about how they can do more business in a gala dinner situation or a cocktail night than they do on the trade floor. So that kind of thing, I just think it's got an edge that will never be completely replaced by virtual. But having said that, by offering hybrid, at least you can keep engaging with people. And if it's done interactively and you use the right technology, it can then just be a really great showcase of your venue, of your destination, so that when we can all travel again, people are, you know, keen to hop on a plane and come and do it in person.
Thanks, Tom. Alito, do you think post-COVID, whenever the travel restrictions are lifted, do you think there's going to be a big influx of people wanting to get back to live events?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think there's a few considerations to be taken there, right? You know, one of my favorite quotes, the late great Kobe Bryant was asked what drove him. And he said that understanding that what got him to the point that he was at wasn't what was going to keep him there. And I think that's something that resonates, I think, with our industry very much now, is understanding that what got us up to this point is not what's going to keep us there post-COVID. So I think absolutely, you know, we as humans are hardwired to want to have interaction. You know, there's enough studies done, you know, when you're looking at child development and touch and how that affects the child's development, to understand that we as humans, we want to have that face-to-face interaction. But at the same time, interestingly enough, when you look at studies on delegates on how they prefer to interact, at least with, let's say, the administrative portion of events such as registration, such as going through and picking up all of their collaterals and all that, by and far, they say, hey, we want to have something that is touchless and that is highly customizable and personalized to me. So, you know, just in that fact, you also see that everybody wants to have at least some type of an AI component, which is able to tell you without any hassle. You don't need to tell them a million times, right? You've gone to the event once. The next year when you go, it already has all your preferences in there for you. So I think that it's all just about adaptability, but absolutely, I don't think that, you know, there's a huge risk that no one's going to want to travel once, you know, that kind of fear of traveling gets past, whether that's, you know, Q2 next year, end of next year, or whenever it is. I think that as travel starts picking up, it'll be fine. I do think, though, that there needs to be a slight shift in the business model. And, you know, we already see that a lot of venues around Asia, in fact, are already having, you know, hotels are setting up virtual studios in some of their ballrooms to be able to cater to that. So I think that there's going to be a much bigger market for hybrid, at least next year for sure. But live events, just because of the way that we're wired as humans and the way that we want to be able to experience things, you know, we'll go back to that.
Yeah, thanks a lot. So you sort of led me on to the next question about, you know, how does the industry in Macau prepare themselves or start working towards catering for this? How do they leverage the opportunities coming from the hybrid the hybrid world? What can they do?
I mean, I think
hotels, the venues, the suppliers.
You know, Macau is a tough market in the sense that so much of it is inbound. You know, I mean, even if you just look across the river in Hong Kong, you have quite a rich corporate client database. But you know, Macau, really, you don't have a lot of corporate clients. So most of the clients that you're getting, it's all inbound and it works great. It's a fantastic destination. You know, we do events all over the world, all over Asia Pacific. And honestly, when you're talking about venues, Macau is still probably one of my favorite places to produce events in and produce experiences in. But I think what we're seeing and what I think is going to work for Macau, at least in the short and midterm, is a what we call a hub and spoke approach. So what we've been designing for a lot of our clients, particularly, let's say, like incentive groups. So this has worked well for four or five different insurance companies that we normally design an incentive conference for them, is that we're doing pretty much each location regionally hosts a live event. And then we're linking up virtually to the other locations. So when you're looking at, you know, the government slowly opening up the borders, hopefully by September we'll be open to, they'll be open to all of China. So you know that those companies and those clients can already start coming in, and you can do something like that where the China contingent comes into Macau and they host an event. And then maybe you have, you know, one speaker here, you have one speaker in Singapore, one down in Australia, and we do the event live for everybody. Certain portions of it are virtual, certain portions of it are live. They go into breakouts where they just do their own thing. So it's all about just being creative with that. But I think that comes down a lot to us as the producers and as the agencies, understanding how we need to be able to design the experience to be able to cater to again meet the needs of the clients.
Thanks, Alonso. I mean, Greg, what in terms of looking at meeting spaces in Macau, what do they sort of need to be thinking about in terms of infrastructure or software? Do they need to reconfigure themselves or rethink of how they're doing it? We've seen some good examples of, I think Alonso mentioned that there are venues like Marina Bay Sands in Singapore, and there's a couple of the ICC Sydney and MCEC in Melbourne. They're setting up in-house studios and broadcast studios. Greg, do the hotels and venues need to think about where they're at and what they need to facilitate this new age?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. I think, you know, going back to Alita's point, if anything, I think Macau is actually in a really good space, because if you're going to give me an excuse to actually have to travel, I want all the entertainment and the lifestyle and the dining and things. I need that, because otherwise I might as well be on Zoom or whatever. I might as well be stayed in the virtual space. Something has to be in a draw, right? And I think Macau is probably maybe better positioned than a lot of cities for that. So I think as far as the candy of getting people back on planes and wanting to go, I think Macau is very well suited. But when you come to the part of doing the taking care of the hybrid at the same time, yeah, you're going to need to make sure that the pipeline is really good, that your data in and out, and you can do some really high level feeds of data moving things back and forth. I think you're going to need a really good studio. I mean, a place where it's really conducive. When you do a live event, you can do 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, all day sessions, and you can't do that online. Online, we've learned that attention span on most webinars and that are about 40 minutes, 60 minutes is really, you're at the end, right? That the attention to be able to get up and go out and get a drink of water, get a coffee and to walk away from the screen, you don't have people as a captive audience. So I see people, a presenter on stage doing a keynote session for everybody, maybe that's broadcast, or maybe actually there's like parts that broadcast, and then they step off the stage and they go into a broadcast studio and they've got a different content feed going for that audience. This is a live event and an online event are not like for like. It's not a direct transfer of content. And like I said, we've had a couple of clients in China. Like I said, the ones that switched over 10 days later, they were supposed to do a live event, switched it into a digital event. And then they suddenly watched the drop-off rate of people online being dropped off. They couldn't take the whole meal of the whole entire day's agenda. So yeah, I think there's preparations that we do on that side. But I think the more and more we're comfortable with what the virtual space is doing, as opposed to being afraid of it. How do we work that? How do we work that into it?
I've seen a bit of that with some of the webinars I've been attending over the last couple of months, where people, they're feeding their cats, their dogs, so they get distracted very easily when they're online. Like, they have got that sort of focal point. Yeah. What about the PCOs, the exhibition management companies, and the event companies in Macau? I mean, what do they need to be thinking about? Who do they need to be? Do they need to be partnering with technology companies? What do they need to be doing? I'll pass that one to Tom. What do you think this sector of the industry needs to be doing now?
Sure. So I think one of the main challenges that comes with hybrid is you've essentially got an entire different audience that needs to be managed, communicated with, and engaged with as part of the event. So I think having a technology platform that connects all of your different aspects together, they're the companies that are really in an advantageous to pivot towards a hybrid event, where their live event technology has then a virtual component to it. In the last few months, we've seen quite a few different solutions pop up where it's just that virtual piece. And people have, grabbed that, maybe it has a nice feature set, and they've bolted that onto their existing database and technology stack. And that causes issues in terms of having those different databases and things connected. When you've got, for example, for a hybrid event, you've got your attendee app as part of the same native suite of tools as your online virtual interactive tool. What that means is the people in the room using the attendee app or the people online using the virtual tool are all part of the same conversation. And that gives me a sense that if I'm online, I'm not the poor cousin to the person in the room. I'm actually still interacting. I'm part of the conversation and I'm still part of that experience. I think one of the other parts that probably hasn't got as much airtime as it has, and it's probably because we haven't really pivoted as much as we will to hybrid, is all the challenges in a post-COVID world that we're going to face around logistics. How do we plan out the room space, the social distancing? New Zealand's a really interesting example. So New Zealand got a very early hold on the COVID epidemic. They shut down their borders. And for about 10 weeks, they didn't have any new cases, which was absolutely fantastic. Unfortunately, there was a slight breakout recently, which I think they've jumped on top of. But they were a good example of what will happen when we start snapping back from these restrictions to allow business events. So they went first to 100 and then 200 and larger business events. And one of the key requirements the government put in place, and any sensible government around the world will do the same, is contact tracing. So if you're inviting people into a room, they're going to come in, they're going to mingle, they're going to, you know, hopefully socially distance. But what you will need to be able to do is to trace those people coming in, not just your event, not just a simple check-in report, but are able to see who went into which session at which time, who went into this networking function when they came out. So we can really quickly report on that. Should something happen, should there be an outbreak, we can really quickly pull a list out. And you mentioned the ICC down in Sydney earlier. I think they've done a fantastic job with both of those components. So the bit we've talked quite a bit about is the creation of the content, the streaming of the content, the stage setup. But also what they've done is they've recreated their space to encourage social distancing and to really facilitate that quite stringent access control, which will be an incredibly important part of a post-COVID business events environment.
Yeah, look, you've touched on a few really good things here in terms of what you need to think about beyond just trying to do on-site event versus doing it on a hybrid platform. I'm really interested in what sort of technologies are coming into play. You've mentioned a few, Tom, they're coming into play to try and replicate or create the same sort of live experience. So I was going to ask Greg, mate, I know you're working a lot of your virtuosity and some products that you're putting out in the marketplace now. Where's that taking us for hybrid to try and replicate what's going on in the live situation? What can we do? What are the possibilities to address networking and business matching and all the things that are important to a live event?
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the first things people always ask me in these webinars is, you know, what software program should I get? You know, it's always the first one. Because I think people are just looking for the answer. It must be a software program and I can just put it in here. And when we went, you know, again, we were all full of shock. We were running back we started looking through them all, and they really are quite dated. They're quite dated, they're quite clunky, they're quite old. But each one of them has got an advantage. And so what we did was we went back and we said, well, let's think about, instead of thinking about what software package we are doing, which is a very easy trap to get into, let's go back to what our core job is, which is experience design. And then we would start to figure out what kind of online experience do we need to create. And from that, I think there's a variety of folks to be able to use. We built some of our own. So we house and we have got the backbones for it. So we built our own in-house applications. We sometimes will bolt on a Zoom component to it, or we'll be building 360 VR type experiences that will plug into it. The trade show spaces, we may take some of the work that we're doing and combine it with a different platform. Or we'll use our own. So again, I think what we wanted to have was enough color in the palette and the color palette so we can pick and choose to craft and be craftsmen, as opposed to just running to a software package and trying to sell through or do a value add on top of the software package, because I don't think that's going to get us to do great experience design.
Yeah.
But once you get into those spaces, you know, again, you have to look at what are the advantages of a live experience. And like we said, the emotional content, the kinship that you get with going to an event, the entertainment and of entertainment and dining and the experiences there. But also online comes with a completely different asset of advantages, you know, being able to track where people were on, how long they were tracking from, you know, what sessions were they engaged with. You know, we get a lot more data from them. And then when you are doing registration process, you can do matching. One of the hardest part is going into the ballroom. I mean, on the positive side, going into the ballroom with or having a dinner with everybody, I can go table to table and really meet a lot of really great people. But also on the other side, the advantage of being in a virtual space is that my matchmaking can also be just as strong, right? So there are three people in this room I want to meet. You know, then I can give you that answer question, and you can go through the data and find the three other people that are looking for me. And when that starts to happen, you have value. And the last thing you and I talked about last time is, like, can we make money at all this? As long as we are providing value, we can make money. You know, if I can go into a room or if I can go to a conference and I am getting content that I would never have gotten anyplace else, then I walk away and I close down that computer or I put my head on the pillow in the resort and go, that was a great day. You know, so as long as the content is great, the people I can meet is great, and experience is high. You know, I think we can always end up making money.
One of the big questions you kind of raise is this question of ROI. How does a organizer get ROI? How does an association or corporate get ROI? How do the delegates, how do the sponsors, exhibitors get ROI? Are there any good case studies of ROI or proof in the pudding that going hybrid is generating those returns on investment? I'll start with you, Greg, but I'd like to hear from Alinto and Tom as well, if I can.
Well, I mean, I think for Yonex, I mean, just to give something familiar, I mean, we talked about that. That was 1,650,000 people. You know, that suddenly gets a bigger, greater audience. So the ROI to Yonex is very, very happy. You know, we've seen the same thing in car launches. It's very common now to think of the car launch in China as a broadcast studio. So whether the 650 or whether it's 2,000 people I can get into a ballroom or a ballroom space, what I'm doing, I mean, there's a great BMW success story about, you know, the online audience, like weeks before, were able to vote and figure out which singer do they want to launch the event, what song do they want to sing. And so the online audience, there was such a build-up to the online audience, right? So that people go to the event, the VIPs that got invited to the event, there's a live experience, great. It's broadcast, and I think it was like 5 million people online watching the experience. That converts into people signing up for some of the highest rates they ever had for test drives, you know. So there are ways to get your ROI out of it for each one of these companies, you know, and I think the more and more the venues and the organizers are combined together, I think the stronger proposition you can get to that brand and the more 360 offering that they're getting.
Yeah, look, I pulled up some figures on one of your case studies too, and I mentioned to you earlier, and I was quite staggered by the stats, but you had the World Intelligence Congress and Exhibition this year, over 340,000 exhibit views, 100 million viewers and 700 million page views. That's pretty staggering figures you can never replicate in a live situation. So it's certainly something for organizers to really focus on and see how they can benefit from this. Right?
Well, I think the lucky part is that the engine here for Macau is coming from China. And because of where they are, and because of their engagement online, I think it's a great advantage for Macau.
Especially being in the same time zone, you've got that huge audience right in front of you. Mm-hmm. So doing hybrid or virtual, you've got that instant access to massive markets, and you're getting the people that what would normally not come to an event, right? But just wondering, Alinto, have you got anything to add in terms of ROI for events?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think to be quite frank, Greg said it beautifully, really. but I'll say this. I'd like to highlight one thing that Greg mentioned a couple of times, and that's content. Content is still king. And, you know, everybody freaks out and asks the same question about, oh, what about the software? But really, at the end of the day, content is still king. So, you know, I mean, to put it in that sense, when you think about it, whether as a venue or whether as a producer, when we're doing live events, a ballroom is nice, but people choose that ballroom. You know, you can have the greatest venue in the world. If you still put together crap content, you know, no one's going to enjoy it. But, you know, in terms of some great case studies, look, we did a recruitment campaign for one of our insurance clients who we've worked with for a long time. And we've been doing this recruitment campaign for them already for 2-3 years to get new agents. Normally, we get about like between 300 to 500 people signing up to go for it. Generally, you know, we get a positive audience feedback of something like 60% normally. You know, 60% of the people when we do a post event follow up with them, they'll say, hey, yeah, you know, this was really interesting. I want to try and sign up. So we did one 2 months ago for them, and we ran it out of Singapore because that's where the company's HQ was. But we had 2,400 people sign up and watch the event. 1,500 of which later said that they were interested in at least joining the company if they could. We had 80% audience feedback. So you know, I think that was really good, and we were able to track much more specifically, and which Greg also touched on, why and what resonated well with them. So because of that data, now you're able to make really informed decisions for the next time that you're doing this event, whether it's live, virtual, you know, or hybrid, because you have all this extra data that, that now you've been able to capture. Another example was for an education company out here in Hong Kong. We were going to do a small conference for them. You know, it's going to be 300 people. We ended up doing about 500 live, but 4,700 viewers online, which they would have never had otherwise. We were able to bring in speakers, which were not going to participate in the session because of really they just didn't want to commit to having to travel to Hong Kong and you know, spending two, three days there doing the conference. But because we were able to pretty much just dial them in, you know, they were able to share during the conference. So the content itself was also elevated. So, you know, there's so many cases of that. Another one, which actually we spoke about last week when we caught up, was one that we did out in the Netherlands for a healthcare company. And they do an association, actually, right? So they do this Congress. Normally it's 1,000, 2,000 people. You know, we did it for 100,000 and we captured all this content. We created an AI platform for all of the delegates to be able to access over the span of a year. And it tracked pretty much, hey, look, this was the stuff that you were interested in during the Congress. Here's new articles that are coming out online, which match your interests. So, you know, there's so much additional value, but I think that it comes down to two things. Like Greg said, number one, it comes down to content. At the end of the day, that's still why we go to events. You know, and number two, it comes down to data. Now we have so much more data. So, you know, how are you able to really accurately take this data and be able to add value to the content that you're creating?
This is really putting a really good case towards the value of hybrid. Are you seeing any evidence of this being monetized? Obviously, for associations that are worried about their future of their conferences, and any event organizers worried about the financial side of it, are we seeing this being monetized in any way? Tom, do you want to sort of comment on that?
Yeah, so one of the big virtual events over here in Australia quite recently was MEA, Meetings and Events Australia. It's a big association for meeting planners, venues, hotels, and a real catch-all for, I guess, the MICE industry here in Australia. And they really wanted to come out and lead from the front by running a virtual conference. They ran it from Melbourne, which I think you're based down in Melbourne, and you know, it's currently the most lockdown state in Australia. But basically what they did is they set up a hybrid studio and broadcast out to their members and attendees all over Australia and around the world, actually. Now, they charged for their tickets. And at the time, even still now, I think there's this understanding that or a belief that anything online is going to be free. You know, paying for just a virtual event can be a bit of a hard sell sometimes. So they came out and said, no, we're going to put on some fantastic content. We're going to have industry leading speakers. And we think this is content people will want to pay for. And we're going to charge for that content. They went out and did that. They kind of took a bit of a leap of faith with that. And in fact, they did quite well. I can't obviously share the figures on what they achieved with you, but they were able to charge quite a reasonable amount for their tickets. We're talking in the hundreds of dollars, which for a virtual event is kind of unheard of. It was a full day conference. There was speakers from all around the world, some really, really good content. And the feedback they got was fantastic. Going back to what both Greg and Alinta have said, that content is king. And if you've got really high quality content, people are willing to pay for it. It's, you know, like when Netflix came out and you could watch everything for free on YouTube, and that seemed like not the best value proposition. But I think they've proven it, and as did Mia, that if you've got that fantastic content, people will pay for it. When we all caught up the other week, we talked about, you know, the music industry, newspapers all went through this challenge. When it went online, all of a sudden the idea was we wouldn't have to pay for it. I think events are going through that at the moment, but if you can get it right, you can provide actual value to your attendees, there is money to be made. And that's not even to mention the lower costs that you're paying for venue, for insurance, for food, those kind of things. So virtual is definitely a challenge around generating that revenue, but it's definitely able to be done.
Essentially a combination of both content and the audience. And certainly from what Greg and all of you said today, certainly hybrid and virtual can get you a really good audience, a much broader audience than just live events. So in that sense. What about the challenge of personalizing events, like really looking at it where you've got close, when you go to an event, you want to network, you want to do a private conversation with somebody, you want to build relationships. How is the virtual and hybrid technology addressing this? Are there solutions there for this type of activity? I've heard a bit of what Greg said before. Greg, do you want to sort of comment on this first? And I'll go ahead.
It's a natural fit. I mean, you know, we have providers that are doing a really good job of registration, right? And I think when you get a really good registration software, EventX, and some of these other stuff that are coming up, it's really good for matching. I think when you start dealing with hybrid, you know, so we're used to going into a live event and doing some of our registration formats and trying to do matchmaking. Online, obviously, it's quite simple. So I think now when we start talking about hybrids, how can I tag a live event attendee with somebody who's online, right? And how can I get somebody who's online who can't make it to the event and tag them into meeting the people who are at the conference or at the event? So right now we're trying to build the hooks to make sure that those connections also work, because if I've got 1 million online and 650,000 at the venue, why should we not have 1,650,000 people all being able to do matchmaking within that pool? I think the cables for those are being built. I think it's something that we're working on now.
So it's not quite there yet, but it's getting there.
Everybody's running as fast as they can, I think, now.
Tom or Linda, you got any final comments? I'd like to sort of wrap up with this just before we open up the Q&A.
Sure. No, I mean, I think nowadays, like Greg just mentioned, hybrid events in and of itself, because of the way that you're able to set it up with apps and the data that you already capture right in the beginning, matchmaking becomes so much easier. And Greg actually said it in one of his previous comments where, you know, it's always awkward. You walk into the networking section and you don't know who you're going to want to talk to. Sometimes you end up talking to someone and like 2 minutes in, you're like, oh crap, actually, I really don't want to talk to this person, but I can't be rude and walk away. So now it's much easier, right?
But you can do that online now. You can be rude online, right?
Yeah, exactly, right? You just log off. You're like, oh, internet problems. So it's much easier for you to match. But even that, you know, I mean, you're also seeing people kind of have Zoom fatigue and all this where maybe they don't just want to stick to that medium. And we're seeing new things come up, you know, where it's gamified, where you're having, you know, virtual room escapes and virtual puzzles and that kind of interaction and collaborativeness, where people can go in and it might be around a topic. And so you at least still facilitate that conversation in a certain way when people don't want to, you know, it might be a little bit awkward for them in the beginning to be able to connect and start a conversation, even if they know that they have mutual interests.
A good like icebreaker, or it's kind of an icebreaker, yeah, or casual approach, exactly, to networking. Exactly. Right? Yeah. Okay. Look, I need to wrap up a little bit. Go back to Nigel. Have we got any questions online from the groups?
No, there's no questions in the chat.
Okay. Does anybody want to, if you've got any questions, just put them up online. But we did have a few questions that came in before this.
Sorry, Mike. Connie would like to ask a question. So I'll unmute. Connie, go ahead.
Thank you for the sessions. It's very nice. And I got a question. We are talking about millions and millions of people coming to the virtual events. That sounds really great. But how about the marketing? How do you do the pre-launch marketing, particularly when the speaker is talking about in such a rush and you suddenly got all these events up and running? It seems like maybe everybody just staying at home, so it's got nothing to do, so it's just following you right away, only with such a short notice, and then they would just jump on board to be with you. What do you see as a strategies to get the words out in terms of the promotion? Because it would be easiest for people to do the virtuals to spread around the words, but you don't want to have everybody just coming in free of charge. You're getting the information out, right? So I just want to get some advice. How would you do, or what you have done in terms of marketing the event?
Okay, maybe I'll pass on to Tom to start with and go on to Greg and Alinto if you've got comments.
Yeah, sure. And I think Alinto and Greg will probably provide a better insight on this than me, being on the kind of coalface of being event producers themselves. I think you're absolutely right, Connie. The shorter lead times are one of the massive challenges with events in general. And And with virtual, it's gotten even worse. And the other challenge, I think, I'm talking about challenges and not solutions here, is there's just such a large amount of noise out there in the industry at the moment of everyone, every man and their dog running webinars and you know, doing virtual events as well. As for the solutions, I'm sorry, I'm all ears to Olinto and Greg for that one.
No pressure. Olinto, I'm sure you've got the answers here, mate. What's the answer?
Wow, man, I'm glad I sold myself as such a provider of solutions. No, I think, you know, Connie, we're all going through the same challenge, but I think at the end of the day, and Tom actually touched on this when he was talking about one of your clients, it really comes down to content and focusing on what your target audience cares about. I don't think that the rules of marketing have changed at all. If anything, it's just become a lot more meaningful. So, you know, I'm sure that everybody on this call today is getting, you know, 10, 15, 20 emails of spam a day inviting you to join a webinar. But, you know, a clear example is today. Why did you join today? Because you thought that the content was going to be good, because, you know, you probably saw Mike's name on the poster and you were like, I want to hear what Mike has to say. You know, so at the end of the day, I think that there's a lot more focus on content and being able to get it and target it to the right audience. So for example, we're working right now with a very specific legal firm that's based out in Canada, and they have a very specific target market in Asia that they want to target to. So, you know, we have 3 weeks to kind of put together this campaign for them for the series of webinars that they're going to be doing. And we're partnering with online communities which have very similar niche groups that share those kind of interests of what the webinars are going to be. So I think it's on us as producers and as organizers to much better understand who the target market is and understand where they're interacting, and then be able to get the word to those locations. Because, you know, like Tom said, there's so much noise out there. Like, why do you care, right? It's the age old question. Why do I care? Why should I join this session?
Yeah. It's also within a very much shorter time frame too these days with virtual hybrid, right? So that's certainly a challenge for everybody. What about Greg? Have you got anything to add there?
Actually, I love the question, because I think the marketing side of it and getting people online sometimes gets lost in the equation. And I think it's important to put that marketing phase and getting people online and starting to build the audience up. I always thought it was funny because when I used to do events years ago, I was voted on how clever and creative my event was and how fun it was. And then now today I'm responsible at a car launch to make sure that people sold cars. So my ROI moved up, right? So obviously if I'm going to be responsible for that, I need to be making sure that the right people are in the room or the right people are online. I think, you know, as the guy said, you know, as Tom and Alita said, you know, you've got to make sure you know what your target market is, really understand who your target market is, and then how am I going to find that target market? Now, I can find that target market by either going through any kind of an online profiling, right? So there's more than ways of spending some budget into sourcing those folks online, whether it's through advertising, whether it's through networking, or whether it's partners databases that I've invited to the conference and events, so I really understand the market. And then making sure that I've got the right time to be able to do it, and I'm using the right advertising, marketing, and PR strategies to be able to capture that market. But again, if I do it at the last minute and the content's not compelling and it looks like just a regular webinar and not value to me, then that will drop off. So you've got to make sure that the content is really keen. I'd say make sure that you've got enough timeline to do it. Make sure your target market is really defined and you know how to attack the target market.
Thanks, Greg. Nigel, any more questions?
Yeah. So one question from Rod is, in your opinion, roughly what proportion of traditional MICE events are likely to become exclusively virtual?
Greg, maybe.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know whether I have an idea of what percentage. I think some will move online. I don't know whether some platforms will be just online, and I think those are platforms that are very already in that space. I don't see any company that's been doing live events to go virtual and then never do a live event again. I think that's tiny, right? I think you know, if you take, you know, give me an example, I keep using the 650 and the 1 million. I bet you next year, if things are then, that what that 650 will be, you know, 1,000. You know, I think that audience will continue to grow. But if you take that down, maybe an audience is only 200 people. I think those events will have consistency over time. I don't see people doing online only as a, I only see it as a percentage. I don't see live events. I think live digital events that are created online for digital spaces, I think maybe the opposite. I think they might actually, they might actually end up wanting to do a live event after a while.
Thanks, Greg. Nodge, anything else?
No, that's it.
Okay, we did have one other question. We're just on time now, but our panelists did agree to stay online for a few minutes if there is additional questions. So if you've got anything you want to ask, either put it on chat or flag it with Nigel. But we did have a question, a pre-question that came in about developing a China food exhibition. Assuming that means how do we create an event that takes advantage of hybrid technology? We had a quick chat about that before the session. I'll start off again with Greg, I guess, on that.
Yeah, In fact, it's funny with the food thing. I was talking to someone from the U.S. Just last week. Did the trade event for food and this was an association, but they found that they were still charging for booths and exhibits, and they charged $3,000 to create a virtual booth, digitally. So they got all the exhibitors in there. They lost about 30%, but they had about another 25% of brand new people joining onto those events. I think on food events, I mean, if it's just, are we talking about a food event as an activation? There's a few of these coming around where a restaurant, where the restaurant can do live broadcasting from restaurants and venues and things like that, and then do delivery to homes. There's a few of that stuff going on, especially in Singapore. I'm noticing Singapore is doing a lot of that, where they're just combining both hybrid, right? So I'm cooking in a restaurant, I'm a good chef, you're watching me, I'm interacting with people who are at their homes. I'm gonna break off into videos and sourcing where the ingredients came from. And then the Uber Eats guy shows up and delivers and knocks on your door, and then you're ending up with the same meal that we just cooked from the chefs. I mean, we have a lot of these little hybrid type of experiences coming through.
Any other comments from Lito or Tom? The challenge with food is obviously you want to experience the taste and the smell, yeah. That's the biggest challenge with that type of thing, but you put some ideas that could work out.
But creative thinking.
Lito?
Being
based in Macau where the focus on food is very high, you've got to have some good comments in.
Oh yeah, no. I mean, I think you know, food is. I love the.
We've lost you, Alinta. Okay.
I think one of the things I've seen done really well, if I could wrap up there, was kind of a marrying of the virtual and the physical world. So we with a virtual networking function that we have in our platform. One of our customers actually a couple of days beforehand sent out a little swag bag of food and cheeses and wines for the attendees. The idea was they jump onto this virtual networking function where they're on a virtual table with some other attendees. And the idea was they'd pull out their little bottle of bubbly and some cheese and wines from the sponsors, and they'd all tuck into that while the video was on and they were having a chat. And I thought that was a fantastic, really creative use of a simple tool set that we already all have. You know, you could do that kind of thing on Zoom. But the experience it creates for the attendees was just far beyond anything else you'd ever get out of just a good old-fashioned Zoom. So I thought that was a really good example.
Yeah, I saw that happen out of New Zealand. There was a convention. I think it's a Rotorua Convention Bureau. They were doing a virtual site inspection. Mm. And they sent food parcels or picnic hampers to their clients in Australia. And they enjoyed that hamper while the Rotorua was actually doing a presentation on Rotorua, and that it was a very creative. So it's a bit of creativity in going to some of these concepts.
Another one, class as well. So they got little bottles of alcohol sent out to them and the mixers, and they were supposed to make cocktails. I'd personally feel a little bit worried doing that at my laptop, but I thought that was another really interesting blend of the two.
Yeah, well, it's always good to finish on food because I think it's coming up to lunchtime in most places, and
there's still one more. got
one more question.
Yeah, but the one question that come in, that's that there's a trend towards multi-hub events,
yes.
and do the panel see that sort of continuing and sort of the death of mega events? So will it become more multi-hub style events?
Alinto, do you want to sort of mention a bit of that earlier?
Alinto's just coming back into the room. I think he got cut off.
He's still, okay. Did Greg or?
Look, I mean, I think Alinto did mention that. I mean, I think hubs is part, but the problem is then you have content coming from many feeds. I think there would still need to probably be a central hub, right? I think he talked about the spoke system, right? I think there's always going to be a headquarters for where you're going to do things and you're going to beam things in from different spaces, possibly. I think that's a, depending on experience design, if that works, right? But I don't see all this, it just be spokes and no hub. I think behind that question, it sounds like, you know, I'm waiting for the really large events that we're used to. I think that's going to, be honest, I just think that's going to take us a while to build up. And that's just based on a comfort factor. I think we'll be comfortable, you know, I'll be comfortable commute from Hong Kong to Macau, right? Yeah. And then I might be able to go to Taiwan. And I mean, you know, my neighborhood's going to be a little bit short for a while before I'm ready to do those big things. You know, we work up with Ultra, right? In Abu Dhabi, and the same type of thing. 40,000 people at a concert, right? I don't think it's going to take us a while to build back up to 40,000 people at a concert. But what we're looking at doing is creating a really wicked online experience, and then having a smaller concert in Abu Dhabi, and then we can build it up over the years as people become comfortable. And gosh forbid COVID 2 or COVID 3 come around, we still have an online experience going on. But you know that the second, if I've been watching that concert for 2 years, the third year, it's like I'm in New York and I've never been to Abu Dhabi, but my goodness, I've been to Abu Dhabi for 3 times now. It's like, I want to go, right? Suddenly that destination is still point of mind. Yeah. One last one is, I got to say, New Zealand did an exceptional job in a new program they have for promoting New Zealand. They built a whole online experience, right? I mean, you can go through different parts of New Zealand and it's done probably video and it's all done virtual, but no one can travel there. But the point is they built that so that everybody's still got a good, strong relationship with New Zealand. So when it comes back online, it's top of mind. So there are definitely some clever stuff that people have been doing with that kind of draw and building online first and then building them up back into an audience of live.
I've also seen a bit of a trend towards the idea of doing more road shows than before, going, taking events on the road. Are you seeing that pick up or trend, Brett?
Not yet, but I could see that, you know, bring the show to you. I think it just depends on, you know, every one of our countries are in different status.
Yeah.
You know, as more and more we can build these travel bubbles, I think we'll start building travel bubbles within the spaces. But I think right now the road shows, I think what they'll do is they'll have local communities execute there. I do have that because I do have travel retail clients. And so now what's happening is they're trying to activate within city by city.
Alinto, I see you back online, mate. Do you want to comment on the idea of doing hub and spoke events and if you've got any comments on roadshows?
Yeah, sure. I think the most important thing is have a backup connection always. No, it's good to be back. I think, you know, I caught Greg's answer there, and I think absolutely. I think it's probably what's going to end up happening, particularly, you know, when you're talking about roadshows. I don't see roadshows happening for a bit. I think it's going to be a lot more very localized. Either within a bubble or really setting up a local team to activate that brand locally, even if it's the same content, sort of in a sense that's traveling from destination to destination. So I think that's important. But I think also, to be able to make the experience special, even when you're looking at that kind of hub and spoke approach, I think that within a local environment or within a regional environment, you need to have content which is going to be unique to that destination, which is going to really resonate with that destination. And actually, I think that that's kind of a cool opportunity in a sense for us as designers, because one of the biggest challenges that you have is, you know, when you have a multinational client and you have an audience from, you know, 6, 7, 8 different countries, you're bringing them all together and you're trying to design content which is going to be equally resonating to all of them. Whereas with this, you can take general content, which you know will connect with all of them, but and then, you know, during breakouts or during, you know, key moments throughout the event, you can really target things that's really going to resonate to them and their culture and where they're from in that space. And so I think that that's really cool. It gives us an opportunity to further personalize the way that we design events for our clients and brands.
Excellent. So, Nick, we've got time for one more question. And if there are any other questions, you can send the questions through to us and we'll send them through to the panelists and get their responses. So, Nigel, we're getting one more question.
Yeah, there's one more question. And could you recommend some tools, software, or apps that might be useful for a hybrid event?
Okay. I'll go start with Tom.
Yeah, well, I mean, shameless plug of our company. is an integrated end-to-end event platform, runs a lot of really large live events pre-COVID and now has a very powerful and flexible and interactive virtual component as well. So in that pivot that we've all talked to back to hybrid, something that's connected end-to-end is definitely really important. But, you know, we're not the only, fish in the pond. So definitely look around, do your research and find what works best for you.
Yeah. Greg, you can give yourself a plug here, mate, too.
Yeah, either Tom or Greg's Tom's done a very, very good job. Same thing here. You know, I mean, you know, look, any Google will give you VX, V events. And I mean, there must be 10 or 20 and any Google will help you. But I think the point is, I go back to my first comment. I think it's about experience design. I think you've got to really figure out what you're doing. If it's the same thing, you know, Zoom is Zoom, you know. But after a while, you've got to put some production, even in what you've done here, you put some really nice, lovely production. You know where you're switching and you're moving and you know what the content is. I think you're hitting all the sweet spots here, right? Just in the Zoom. So it's a matter of how you're using the softwares, I would say do some research and try to figure out what you're trying to do. And there's a variety, each one is going to have its different assets or custom make it, which is what I think Tom and we are doing.
Okay, I'll finish off quickly with Alento, and then we'll close the session.
Yeah, sure. I think, you know, look, at the end of the day, and not to sound like a broken record, right? At the end of the day, it's still about content. There are great tools out there. You know, Greg was mentioning, even look at what we've done with Zoom today, you know. But yeah, you have stuff like Mural, like Kahoot, like Slido, which is all great. But at the end of the day, and I mentioned this when we caught up, last week, the mindset needs to change, because we're not competing with other events. We're competing with, you know, Netflix. Am I going to spend 3 hours in front of the screen? What kind of content are you going to be providing to me with, and how am I going to be interacting? So even small details like the speakers that you're choosing, are they comfortable, you know, presenting in a virtual space? So do you have a company that's going to come in and help you to curate that content, find speakers that are comfortable speaking and that are good speaking in the virtual space? Or, you know, if you have somebody who's not so comfortable, do you have a team to really coach them and streamline their content and tell them, listen, this is how we need to be able to break it down to make it more digestible? So, you know, even for us, one of the biggest things that we did is we sat down with our L&D team. Actually, our global head for L&D sits in Hong Kong. So we spent a lot of time with his team looking at attention spans and how the brain is able to capture data and pay attention in a virtual space as opposed to, you know, in a digital space as opposed to in a live setting. And so how do we need to bunch content together? How do we need to package that and send it out so that you don't get people dropping off, so that people stay engaged, even if you do have something where you're going to need to stretch it out for a few hours, as opposed to kind of that sweet spot of like 40 minutes, which Greg was mentioning earlier. So, you know, yeah, the software is great, but at the end of the day, it's really, you know, and I know that we've said this over and over again, but it's really about what's the end goal that you're looking to achieve and how do you design an experience to be able to cater to that.
Alento, thanks. Alento, Greg, and Tom, thank you very much for your spilling your minds today. It's been fantastic. I've certainly really found the session very thought-provoking, and I hope this has given everybody in Macau a few new ideas of where to go and how to cope with the new era. And I want to thank especially our three panelists for their sharing their time with us today. It's been fantastic. We can't actually hear everybody clap and everything on this session, but you're all on mute. But there is a little thing on the bottom that says a little icon there says reactions. If you want to do a clap or a thumbs up, please send it through. And we'll wrap up and I'll pass back to Joanna from IPM to tell you about what's coming up soon on IPM's online sessions.
Okay, thank you everyone. And just want to remind you all to training on 2nd of September and 16th of September. So I will see you next week. That's next week. I'll see you everyone. Thank you very much.
Okay, and I just wanted to plug the next two sessions. We've got another lineup of fantastic experts in the industry on AI technology, and we've got a crisis management planning session coming up on the 16th. So we look forward to your participation. And again, I want to thank our speakers and panelists today for their time, and look forward to catching up with every one of you live at some time in the not too distant future. Thanks very much, and we'll see you again soon.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you. Thanks, Mike.
Bye-bye.